pasando una crisis económica. Había mucho turismo del otro lado, Estados Unidos. Había más dinero. Trabajamos en veces no.
Desde el grupo norteño, no es mariachi. Hay más de norteños que de mariachi. Los mariachis son los que traen los sombreros.
Y el mariachi diferencia en que pues es música más como más folclórica, ¿verdad? Los norteños se refiere a, por ejemplo, a bailar polka, a bailar guapango, taconazo, redoba, relatar corridos también.
Tienen prohibido ya los corridos aquí en México. El gobierno pensó que eso alentaba a la gente. Todos los corridos. Antes era, por ejemplo, de un personaje se moría, lo mataban o X y le hacían un corrido. Ahora ya casi lo último es puro narcos. Se refiere a puro narco, puro. Se pueden cantar, pero lo que prohibieron es grabar corridos. Ya, grabaciones de esas. Aquí en México.
¿Nos puede cantar o no?
Sí, claro. ¿Verdad?
DocuBloggers is about community engagement.
It's a television show.
It's a website.
It's a multimedia revolution chronicling life in Central Texas.
Hold on tight.
Share your story. Submit a DocuBlog by September 22nd and get a free t-shirt. All eligible entries will also compete for the grand prize.
Log on to klru.org/docubloggers for more details.
My name is Kieran Fitzgerald. I'm the director of The Ballad of Ezequiel Hernandez, a feature-length documentary. My father, Michael Fitzgerald, produced a film called The Three Burials of Melquiades Estrada with Tommy Lee Jones, and I decided to go and work on the film because I knew about one of the stories that inspired The Three Burials, which was the story of Ezequiel Hernandez. And as soon as I started reading about it, I recognized that it could make a very powerful documentary.
In the summer of 2006, the United States government sent thousands of troops to the border with Mexico. It was the first time that armed military had come to the border in 9 years.
We didn't want to make a Michael Moore film. I didn't want to be in the movie. I wanted to be able to present two sides. In this case, the two sides are clearly defined. A young boy on the border and soldiers, part of our own military. And I wanted to make a film that I could show to people in the military, you know, that they would be able to get something out of, because we had humanized the characters on the military side as much as we'd humanized the young man who was killed.
I still get a few small flashbacks of when
when the shot was fired, and then seeing Hernandez with his feet flying up in the air. That's about the only thing that's really still set in my mind, seeing that.
My background is in literature, and so I am, you know, somebody who's sort of looking for good stories. First and foremost, I felt this was a very powerful story. You know, it could work as a film. I'm also somebody who's political, and I believe that there are things in this country that get pushed out of the way by a very persuasive, dominating media culture. And I wanted to be somebody who was providing an alternative point of view.
I didn't actually see him pointing no gun at me at the point where he got shot. But I was moving, I was trying to get into sight with him. And first story I get, a white man with a little shot is because he was getting ready to shoot at me. And I knew that. For me actually seeing him draw down on me that last time, no.
We were very lucky to have the Austin Film Society organize the screening for us downtown 6th Street in Austin, you know, where I think people were really receptive to the film. And, you know, we certainly saw that after the screening. You know, people asked a lot of questions, and very good questions. I have to say, it was one of the best Q&A sessions that we've had. They were very, very intelligent questions.
One of the interesting ironies about this case is that, you know, two of the four Marines themselves were of Mexican origin. They're Mexican Americans, Roy Torres and Clemente Banuelos. And they came from, you know, a completely different background, of course, growing up on streets of LA. Banuelos had a pretty hard upbringing, from what I understand, as part of gangs and such. Neither of them spoke Spanish. So, you know, the fact that, you know, guys who from one kind of Mexican-American experience ending up in something they consider a war zone in contact with another kind of Mexican-American experience, I think was, you know, an important, powerful irony for this film.
The end of the movie to me is important because it demonstrates that there are relationships between people in the remotest parts of this country and the people at the very top in government. It's not really meant to be a kind of attack on the Bush family or anything like that at all. It's about showing how small the United States is, you know, how intimate a family we are, and that decisions made at the top really do affect everybody. And this is, you know, I think one of the most poignant examples of it. About remembering what the realities are on the border, what we can do, what we've done in the past that doesn't work, and trying to come up with something practical, you know, that's not like a political show of force or, you know, appeasing the right-wing pundits. Or, you know, I mean, the amount of the disconnect between the reality of the border and what most of the country perceives as the reality of the border is crazy, and we want to try and, you know, bring people back to some sense of reality and, you know, remind them of their very recent past.
What is a docu-blogger? A docu-blogger is a creative individual that not only enjoys watching stories about their community, they enjoy telling them as well. Whether they're sharing their opinions through a blog or grabbing a camera and documenting a story as it unfolds, docu-bloggers can find a home at klru.org/docu-bloggers. We invite you to join us in creating and enjoying stories about life in Central Texas.
And we would love for you, if there's any way to mobilize students at St. Joseph's Academy, we would love to have them walk with us, especially that last day. So, well, thank you so much, Tony. All right, God bless you this morning.
My name is Matthew Webster, and I'm a ninth grade English and English as a second language teacher at Simone Rivera High School in Brownsville, Texas. I'm walking on the snowboarder wall walk just to be a voice for the voiceless. I've talked to my students a lot about this issue. We've written letters to Senator John Cornyn and Senator Hutchinson and George Bush. For me to continue being their teacher, I need to show them what it looks like to civilly disagree. And since I've been teaching them that all year, I feel like I probably should walk 9 days for an issue I believe in. I told them when I was in high school, I dyed my hair green for St. Paddy's Day. I was that Irish. And it was really fun talking to them about that because there are a lot of similarities between the Irish immigrants of 100 years ago and Mexican immigrants of today. And so we talked about that. It was really fun to just bring that idea home that we really are a nation of immigrants. And, you know, just because my tie with immigration is my great-great-grandparents from Ireland, it really is close to home for everyone. What, did you bring lots of sunscreen?
I brought a hat.
All right, well, we have sunscreen for you. It's supposed to be 99 today.
That's what I heard.
Hotter than a human heart.
I just honestly didn't think they would go through with the wall.
You didn't think we'd, oh, with the wall. I didn't think so either.
I guess that was very naive, but.
Yeah, I think a lot of people, I mean, good people that we've talked to still say that, you know, like, eh, it doesn't matter. Like, they're not actually going to go through with it. Like, I don't know why you're walking 120 miles. They're not actually going to do it. It's like, well, it's law. And until the law changes, you know, whatever the spirit behind it is, like, until the law changes, it's going to happen unless we can change something.
Right.
Well, it's not the people here who are protesting. The idea is just that, you know, as we're walking and as film crews and stuff are filming, they'll see the river in the background. They'll see the wildlife, you know, coming up out of these fields. Yesterday we had this tremendous scene where these birds were in grass, you know, like up this high or something. And when we walk by, thousands and thousands of birds just explode out. And, like, to the extent that can get on the camera, we will have been a success.
Right.
To the extent people can see, wow, this is where the law's going to go. And to the extent we can talk to people in communities like Gran Hano and show them, yeah, the Rendon family, it's going to go through their backyard. You know, we have to believe that people are good. We have to believe that people just don't know enough about this area and don't know enough about the legislation that they could be in support of a thing like this. You know, we have to believe that. A lot of people immigrating to the United States are poor. But there are definitely a lot of people who spend a lot of money from Mexico and the United States. And, I mean, they have Matamoros, a city which is at least three times as big as Brownsville, to have that cut off. You know, because the wall is obviously not the only gesture that would be made. If, God forbid, a wall actually be built, the border crossings would get much tougher. And it's just a short skip, you know, to a place where it is virtually impossible for people to come over on day visas.
Hey! Hey, guys!
Yes?
Can you give me a really long pee?
Pee!
Hey, guys, can you give me a really short pee?
Pee! Don't give me no walls, no walls, don't give me no walls, no walls, just give me that peace. Oh, that valley peace.
Hey, guys!
Yeah?
Can you give me a really, 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 really long
pee?
I had a student walk four and a half days on the 9-day walk. I was such a proud teacher. Obviously, I feel very passionately about the border wall. This was just one of many volunteer projects we did, but I'm really excited about their taking ownership of this. As we did the walk, as we talked with people about the border wall, so many people's response was, the government doesn't listen to me. And yeah, you might write that off as adult cynicism, but for many people, it starts in high school. And to the extent that I can get rid of that and just empower them to be that change that they need to be, really to have fulfilling lives, to the extent that I can do that, my job is a success.
Amoro.
No, no.
Amoro.
No.
Amoro.
It is about food and about helping people understand about the environment, but it's also about people coming together from different communities, from different backgrounds, and learning about each other. There's nothing like working side by side with someone out in the field, and you feel like you know them, and you know them in a different way. So it's crossing different lines that maybe that don't get crossed in school. And I think that's really powerful, bringing people together, because we have so many different ways that we segregate ourselves community or in society, and I think it's really important to say, how can we bring people together? And food is something that we all, it's common for us all.
We're gonna plant our peppers in these beds here, so that means I'm gonna have to till, and we're gonna have to, you know, we're just gonna have to do a lot of hoeing to stay on top of this, because we're not gonna be able to dig all this out.
Hoping that these young people can really see that there is a serious community problem around hunger and food access, and that they have played a very critical, very hands-on role in solving that problem. So I hope that they take pride over the work that they've been, you know, working together, growing as a team, developing certain personal skills, youth development skills, life skills, that they can really share with the community in a very basic way. And so these skills of growing food, learning about community and cooperation, about hard work, responsibility, these skills are going to be transferable for the rest of their lives.
Program at a youth launch or a nonprofit. We used to have a middle school gardening program, and we decided that if we really wanted to create change around this issue, we should have a program like this. And so we work with 15 young people. It's an after school and Saturday program in the spring. In the summer, we're full time, 5 days a week, and growing food. About 40% goes to soup kitchens and hunger relief organizations, and 60% we sell, and mostly in low income.
That's a great one. That's nice.
So Urban Roots is here today, and they are sending out about 300 freshly harvested heads of lettuce to 300 of our clients that have been identified by our social workers as really some people very at risk of hunger and food insecurity in the home. There's a disconnect between the food that we put in our body and how we've acquired that food. And I think that just so many people don't know how food is grown and where it comes from. And when you don't have that connect, we tend to not nourish our bodies in the best way.
Thing in this, the country, the thing that's really hurting all countries around the world is not being able to eat the food that's grown either by themselves or their neighbors. Because food grown in your own community is fresh, and it's nutritious because it's fresh. Food trucked in is not fresh, and thus it's not nutritious.
So when we hear that there is a group that wants to show young people how to grow food, organically of course, that's very inspiring, and that's what we need. We need this to happen all over the country.
With this program, I'm growing things, and I started. I plant things, I harvest things, I wash things, and soon I'm going to be able to learn how to cook things so that I can give back. And I think that is a great thing for anybody to have, especially youth, so they grow up, and I'll grow up learning how to give back to my community.
I feel pretty good about it because it's what we grew. It's not because they don't usually get food like this every day. I know a million people told you this, but it's really important. They usually don't get food like this every day. So us going there and giving it to them, I know it's helping somebody there. As long as we're helping somebody, I think that's a real cool thing to do.
Not only are we fast, but you look good while we're doing it.
If they never work on a farm again, I think that this experience will bring a new consciousness to every meal that they eat. Or when they talk to their kids someday about, I worked on this farm back then and this is why we're eating this produce. I feel like these experiences will stick with them and will help spread out to their families and in the community as well.
The first step to becoming a DocuBlogger is logging onto our website at klru.org/DocuBloggers.
Exchange your insights and opinions with your community on our blog, watch stories from our broadcasts, view web-only extras, and even add your own DocuBlogs. Find all this and more at klru.org/DocuBloggers.
The dam has held back the waters of Canyon Lake did a pretty good job for about 50 years, and then we had the flood in 2002. And for the first time, the lake actually, what they call spilled. It rose above the level of the spillway, and we had what is now known as the flood of the July flood of 2002. The result of the flood was actually the creation of this gorge. If you can see behind me, and there's some cedar hills back there, this is basically what the gorge looked like early on before the flood. After the flood, after the lake spilled, the power of the water literally took out all the trees, tumbled huge boulders of rocks the size of cars, and created this incredible phenomenon of nature that we call the gorge. The spillway is about 1,000 feet wide, and the water was basically about 7 feet deep going over the spillway for about 3 days. And so that's about 70,000 cubic feet of water a second for a good solid 3 days. And I think it took about 6 weeks for the last little drop to dribble over. But the amount of water that came into Canyon Lake could have filled it up about 3 times.
It's a wonderful geologic find, so it gives a whole lot of unique history all the way back to 110 million years ago. And so the fossils and unique finds that are there help explain what happened in this particular part of the world that many millions of years ago.
The neat thing about this gorge is that it's like a big fat fluffy biscuit. You can just peel off layer after layer after layer, and there's a surprise on every layer. The things that are left behind in the gorge are wonderful geologic sites, exposed faults, exposed workings of an underground aquifer that has been brought to light, lots of sites that scientists can study. When the flood occurred, GBRA approached the Army Corps of Engineers with a proposal to help develop this gorge. The folks in the community were just wild to get into it, and the Corps did not have the time, the money, the staff to do it. And so we found some really movers and shakers in the community, and they formed this action group, and they are called the Gorge Preservation Society and refer to themselves as the GPS.
I live here, and having lived through the flood, not having near the catastrophes and damage that most of the folks have experienced, it's just a unique opportunity to add to the charm of this community and give people something to, another reason to come here. And that's what we're trying to accomplish.
A docublog is a video that tells a story about a person, place, event, or anything else in your community.
It can be funny, serious, concrete, or avant-garde. We encourage you to go out there and share your story with your neighbors. Go to klru.org/docubloggers to find out how.
Become a DocuBlogger. Log on to DocuBloggers.org to share your opinions and story ideas, or get out your camera and create your own DocuBlog.